Hello everyone. Welcome to the Good Governance Academy within the EU-funded project A Sustainable Urban Marketplace in Indonesia. Today's topic is related to an important municipal service, waste management. We will look into the sustainable approaches to waste management, investigate the true cost of waste, and go through the strategies for waste reduction. Good waste management is very important. It is beneficial to human health as it helps to reduce land, water, and air pollution. It helps to preserve the environment and biodiversity, reducing greenhouse gas emissions and protecting plants, animals, and marine life. It decreases the amount of generated waste, helping to save space in landfills and conserve the natural resources. It also supports local economies by creating jobs, improving the sustainability of local communities by allowing for the growth of a circular economy. Waste management in the EU is regulated via the EU Waste Framework Directive, which was introduced in 2008 and updated in 2018. It requires all EU member states to follow the waste hierarchy in their waste management policies and practices. The purpose of the directive is to prevent and reduce the negative environmental and health impacts of waste generation and management. Its main focus is to abandon the linear production model in favor of the circular economy concept, which is crucial to the understanding of modern waste management policies. On this slide, you can see the graphic representation of both models. In a linear economic model, the products are made from raw materials extracted from the earth, and after these products are used, they are discarded and forgotten about. This model would be okay if the natural resources and areas occupied by landfills were unlimited. However, this is not our case. We only have one planet, and its resources are limited. If we want to manage the decreasing natural resources sustainably and deal with our ever-growing volume of waste, we must change our throwaway culture. Only by keeping the resources in circulation for as long as possible, we have a chance to address these problems, improving our lives and guaranteeing a better future for our children. The biodegradable raw materials must be ethically and sustainably sourced, and after the products made out of them are used, any leftover waste should be decomposed and returned to the earth as compost. Technical products must be designed to last for a long time and should be easy to repair, reuse, or recycle. Whenever possible, we must use biodegradable materials to make technical products. For example, biodegradable plastic instead of the one which pollutes our land, air, rivers, and oceans. Our electricity should also come from renewable sources such as solar or wind power. Consumers should be reimagined as users. Products may be leased to users rather than sold to customers. A true circular economy should also focus on restoring natural ecosystems which have been previously destroyed. The main two objectives of the EU Waste Framework Directives are to prevent and reduce the negative impact of waste management and waste generation, and to improve resource efficiency. The directive introduced the zero waste hierarchy concept, which is focused on shifting away from the old throwaway culture to towards a more sustainable approach which prioritizes prevention, reuse and recycling. The main preferred waste management options of zero waste are the 5 R's: refuse, reduce, reuse, recycle and rot. The zero waste hierarchy includes the following levels. Prevention is the most important level of the hierarchy, and it involves avoiding the generation of waste altogether, for example through the zero waste product design and public awareness campaigns aimed at waste prevention and waste reduction. The second and third levels involve waste reduction measures and preparation of products for reuse, for example, by designing products to minimize generation of waste and environmental footprint, repairing or refurbishing products, or donating them to charities. The next, a less desirable level, is recycling. This level involves recycling waste into new products, either through mechanical recycling, where materials are physically broken down and reprocessed, chemical recycling, where materials are broken down into their chemical components and used to create new products, or composting and anaerobic digestion. This topic will be covered in more detail during one of the next lectures. Other recovery. This level includes energy recovery through processes such as incineration or gasification, which convert waste into energy. While this is not as preferable as recycling, it is still considered better than landfilling. And disposal is the least preferred option because it involves landfilling waste that cannot be prevented, reused or recycled. The EU directive requires that waste sent to landfill must be minimized and safe for the environment. On this graph, you can see how the municipal waste treatment in the EU has changed over the last 25 years. As you can see, the focus has shifted from disposal in landfills to prevention and recycling. So, what about the economic component of waste management? In short, waste costs money, a lot of money. The elements of the cost of waste include the cost of waste collection and transportation, cost of waste management itself, cost of the materials used in the processing, cost of waste infrastructure maintenance. The environmental and social costs of waste are often unaccounted for. However, poor waste management practices have a very heavy environmental and social price. Open landfills, for example, are not only the graveyards for a range of non-renewable natural resources, but also serve as a perfect breeding grounds for rodents and mosquitoes, which contribute to the rise in infections among the local residents. Exposure to contaminated water and air can lead to serious waterborne diseases and cancers. Property prices near landfills are also usually much lower than in other areas, and the land occupied by landfills cannot be used for any other purposes for a very long time, which leads to the loss of potential profit. The open dumps are a major source of methane and leachate, and one is a powerful greenhouse gas which contributes to the climate change, and the other one, leachate, is a powerful toxin. Bad waste management practices lead to environmental damage and loss of biodiversity, air, water and soil pollution. And the revitalization of areas damaged by waste require significant investments and a long time. The revenues from waste come from sales of recyclables or byproducts of recyclables, sales of biogas or energy produced in incinerators, waste taxes and fees, and the waste sector funding. The value of waste depends on the value and availability of raw materials, recyclability of the waste materials, their purity and quality, and demand for them. Choosing the appropriate waste handling method will help lower the environmental damage and save the money. The cost-benefit analysis is an efficient tool for decision makers. It can provide valuable information essential for the implementation of holistic and financially integrated schemes, taking into account the local specifics, priorities, and values. Here is an example from Japan. The cost-benefit analysis of four treatment options for biodegradable and food waste, anaerobic digestion, composting, landfilling, and incineration. It showed that the anaerobic digestion had the highest overall benefit, while composting was the cheapest and safest. Incineration and landfill turned out to be the least desirable and most expensive options. On this slide, you can see the results of the benefit analysis according to the four criteria: added value, safety, efficiency, and social benefits. And here are the results of the cost analysis according to another four criteria: disamenity, operation costs, energy consumption, and the cost of securing the environmental safety. In Indonesia, the main waste management method is still landfilling. Open burning and illegal dumping are also quite common. Some of the possible causes for this situation include lack of enforced legislative measures and governmental policies aimed at the minimalization of landfilling. The artificially low cost of landfilling does not include social and environmental costs. High cost, inefficient funding, and low economic benefits of the alternative options, as well as low awareness and behavior issues. The economic instruments for waste reduction include incentives, such as recycling subsidies or a deposit refund return system, in which consumers pay a small deposit on certain packaging and then receive a refund when they return it for recycling. These incentives include weight-based waste disposal taxes, landfill taxes, taxes on the extraction of raw materials, higher taxes for unsustainable products, or extended producer's responsibility tax, which is imposed on producers to help fund the collection, recycling, and safe disposal of their products at the end of their life cycle. Now, let's examine the experience of different European countries related to good waste management practices. Here are the results of the country-by-country analysis of policy instruments which have been implemented in 2001, 2015, in 28 EU countries, Switzerland, Iceland, Norway, and Turkey. The policy instruments included landfill tax, incineration tax, landfill ban on organic waste or mixed municipal waste, landfill tax increased by more than 50%, landfill tax of at least 30 euros a ton of waste and mandatory separate collection of biowaste fractions and pay-as-you-throw or other economic incentives for waste segregation and recycling. The list of the policy instruments is on the left of this slide. The analysis showed that the countries which are using many different instruments have a higher recycling rate than those which are using few or no instruments. The way in which policy instruments are combined may be more relevant than the number of the instruments. Most countries have developed more than two national waste management plans over the period, but the recycling performance differs greatly. There is no systematic difference in performance between countries with national plans and countries with only regional plans. Many countries use pay-as-you-throw schemes in which the fees are based on the weight or volume of the waste. The way such schemes are implemented varies between and within the countries and often depend on the average incomes of local residents. However, all countries with recycling rates above 45% use such schemes, while most countries with recycling rates below 20% do not. It shows that pay-as-you-throw schemes are an effective instrument. And all the countries that show landfill rates well below the European average of 28% have either banned landfilling of biodegradable or mixed municipal waste or implemented such ban in combination with a landfill tax of at least 30 euros per ton. The Dutch model of waste management is centralized and aims at waste reduction and the minimization of the cost of waste. A special body, the Waste Management Council, functioned between 1980 until 2006, and it was dissolved upon achieving the set goals. The Dutch approach is to avoid creating waste as much as possible, recover usable and valuable raw materials, and generate energy by incinerating the residual waste. Landfilling is only allowed for the waste unsuitable for recovery or incineration. The Dutch imposed the extended producers' responsibility model, in which producers or importers are responsible or share the responsibility for the disposal of the products they sell. This is implemented together with the waste management fees in combination with other instruments such as landfill bans, landfill taxes, separate collection, and effective communication with the public. In order to reduce the environmental pressure arising from waste management, stricter standards have been introduced. For example, standards for soil protection in landfills, standards for the quality of secondary materials derived from waste, air quality standards for incineration, quality standards for organic fertilizers produced from biowaste, and a ban on landfilling of all waste suitable for recovery or incineration. As a result, the amount of waste which end in landfills decreased from 35% in 1985 to just 2.1% in 2016, and the recovery rate rose from 50% to 93%. As more and more waste is collected separately. Currently, 77% of all waste is recycled and the residual waste is mainly used for energy production. In Sweden, some municipalities have introduced the pay-as-you-throw scheme, in which the cost of waste collection from households is dependent on the weight of the waste. It made people more conscious about using the waste-generating products as they directly share the costs of waste with the municipalities. Implementing this system has also led to a decrease in the costs of handling waste. The city of Bergen in Norway has introduced a flexible fee model for households with the use of Internet of Things. The Internet of Things is the network of physical objects or things, in this case bins, that are equipped with sensors, software, and are connected to the Internet. It allows them to collect and exchange data, and allows these devices to communicate with each other and with humans, creating a vast network of connected devices that can be remotely monitored, controlled, and optimized. The goal was to reduce the amount of general household waste by rewarding the environmentally aware customers and optimizing selective collection. By making the fees for the general waste more expensive compared to the recyclables, the users were encouraged to separate their waste. This scheme has resulted in the reduction of residual waste by approximately 8% and the increase of selective collection of plastic by 28%, glass and metal for 10%, and paper by 5%. The selective collection of paper had the smallest increase because of the general reduction in the use of paper in our digital era. There was also a considerable decrease of the collection frequency. Needless to say, such activities reduce the waste management costs. However, the introduction of a pay-as-you-throw scheme can sometimes lead to illegal dumping. To combat such activities and improve waste management, in Germany, apart from hefty fines, an app by the name of Malweb was developed. It allows users to report illegal dumping grounds to the authorities. The authorities then collect the reported waste and store it in the designated areas before it's being sent for further processing. Thank you very much for your attention. If you have any comments or questions, please write in the comment section below.